Welcome to Detroit in Black and White. I'm Adolph Mongo. We are at McChain. It's not sunny. There's a lot of ugly little weather here, better than snow.
Keep us on.
Okay. Vanessa Moss, chick starter and political wannabe.
Whatever.
Yeah, right.
A political is being.
Okay.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning to those that are watching Detroit in Black and White. If you're watching it on YouTube, Facebook, X, the gram, thank you. But what we would like for you to do this morning is like, subscribe, and share. Like, subscribe, and share. And good morning to those that watch every week. Duella Boyce, Kara Winston, Dee Holly, Bridget Huff, all those people. Thanks for watching.
Okay. Allan Lengel, co-founder of Deadline Detroit, the Detroit News, Washington Post, and the Eagle American.
Good morning.
How you doing? Before we got a full house today, so but we still gonna do our usual your outrage of the week.
Yeah, we're gonna do our usual because we didn't do it for 2 weeks, and you know I got the business. They were like, you guys didn't do the outrage, you know. So my outrage is this Michigan lawmaker who called those guys that was on the bus, the NCAA basketball players, illegal invaders.
Maddox.
Miss Maddox. Misinformation, spreading misinformation. That's a problem. That is outrageous because you saw all these, let's be clear, black folks, black men on these buses, you decided to spread misinformation. You took pictures, you put it on X. I don't even know if he's retracted the statement or not, but that is outrageous because you know what? You're promoting division, you're promoting hate, but more importantly, you're promoting misinformation. That's ridiculous.
Misinformation, that's shocking that we would have misinformation. I mean, it's, you know, and I know I won't get it to Donald Trump, but I mean, here's a guy who has been successful in sort of degrading the currency of truth, where you talk to some of the people that support him and they don't care what the truth is. It doesn't matter to them. It's like, they want their guy. And that's how we see, you know, that's how we've seen fascism over the years in World War II, pre-World War II. Where
But I blame the media.
I agree.
Because they let folks like Trump and all these Republicans get away with all the BS.
Is it just Republicans? Let's be fair here. It's the whole lot to go around.
Oh, yeah, but I'm not talking about the other lot. I'm talking about Republicans. No, I'm picking and choosing.
Well, I have a question. We have time to play this quick little video of Rona Romney.
Yeah, go ahead.
We talk about
that. Kristen Welker interviewed McDaniel and confronted her about her support of Trump's promise that he will free the January 6th rioters.
Do you disagree with Trump saying he's going to free those who've been charged?
I do not think people who committed violent acts on January 6th should be freed.
So you disagree with that? He's been saying that for months. Rana, why not speak out earlier?
When you're the RNC chair, you kind of take one for the whole team, right? Now I get to be a little bit more myself, right?
Yeah. Before I was carrying water for a fascist wannabe dictator. Now I'm getting bangs. It's fun. You know, frames the face.
Well, they're going to have to pay, and
yeah,
they should
exactly.
Pay. I thought it was a good move on NBC to hire her, because she's in the head of Donald Trump. She knows what's happening. She was a paid hit person for the Republican Party.
And we understand how people are paid
as
hit people. Isn't that right, Mr. Mongo?
That's what I do.
Exactly.
Yes.
So how can we hate on her? And by the way, that
they're
going
to have to pay. They're going to have to pay.
Oh, I'm sure they
ain't no question.
Oh, yeah.
Allan, your outrage of the week.
My outrage is sad. Lizzo is saying she's quitting. She's so mad that people are giving her so much
grief. Who's Lizzo?
Lizzo? So it's a Detroit star who's actually a good friend of mine in New York. He's from Detroit.
I'm under a rock somewhere.
Liz, a good friend of mine.
Yeah, no, but your friend in New York. You're talking
in
about
New
James?
York, his wife.
Right.
Works for Atlantic Records, and she was the one who discovered Lizzo. But
right.
Lizzo is now mad that people are giving her grief. Lizzo is not so nice to people, and she's getting a pushback on it.
Oh, she a diva?
Yeah, yeah, she's a diva. She really kind of a little.
No, she had some issues. People were suing her, saying that she was forcing him to do things.
Right, right.
That tracks and stuff like that. Yeah, yeah. They didn't want to talk about it because of her weight. Stop messing with that woman, okay? This is, by the way, this is Women's History Month. So I'm not going to pick on her. I'm not going to pick on Lona at all. Lona's getting paid. Lizzo's getting paid, and she has the right to change her mind. If you decide that you want to come back, come on back, Lizzo.
I have an opinion. I have mixed feelings about the Romney McDaniel thing. Is that one? I mean, she did have a credibility issue. Is that she said whatever Trump said, even when she did not believe about the election, she kept pushing it and trying to raise questions about it. But ideally, what they should have done is had her on as a talking head. Without pay, with the idea
they got Al Sharpton on the channel, and I don't have a problem with Al Sharpton, but Al Sharpton, he can be full of whatever at times. I thought it was a good move.
I like Al Sharpton,
and let her show how crazy the Republican Party is.
Yeah, yeah. She would have given amazing insights. I mean, we would have got it, and maybe someone else will pick her
but
up.
Although Trump
put on True Social afterwards, he said, because she went after Trump basically and said, I don't believe the January 6th people should be released. Trump put on True Social afterwards and said, Rona McDaniel is in never land. She has no one. She's in no man's land there, basically. So the question is, where is she going to land? But she's going
to
be an asset. She'll be an asset.
She's going to run for president of No Labels with Liz Cheney. anyway, my quick outrage of the week. The young black woman that went to jail in Texas for voting, she was under impression. She had served some time. She was a felon. She voted. They told her she can vote. Got something in the mail, 5 years. The appeals court say, get that woman out of there. This is unbelievable, but that you get 5 years.
The appeals court bounced, let her go.
Yeah, I saw that. That's another whole story.
South
Carolina, whole 2024 election with Matt previously ruled unconstitutional.
So not a constitution. Okay, but anyway, let's take a quick break, and we're going to bring on our first two guests.
Thanks, Charles, for letting me use your gardening supplies. I'll make sure I put it back in the garage. Man, tending to that lawn is a lot of work.
Tell you the truth, Jim, I'm more concerned about keeping this house.
What's going on?
Well, Sarah lost her job 2 months ago, right?
Yeah.
Since we lost that income, the bills have been piling up. And we're so far behind. I don't want to lose the house because of back taxes. I don't know what to do.
I understand. The same thing happened to my sister and her husband when he lost his job. Do you know that the Wayne County Treasurer has plans and programs to help people stay in their homes?
No, I didn't. Tell me about it.
Yeah, go to www.treasurer.waynecounty.com and see if you qualify.
Say that again.
www.treasurer.waynecounty.com.
Got it.
Okay, and we're back. Okay, Vanessa, we're kicking Vanessa off for this segment.
Yeah, I've been kicked off this segment, but if you're watching, remember Vanessa Moss, candidate for 36th District Court Judge.
Okay, write that.
All right, invoice. Make sure you invoice her for that commercial.
Of course. Oh man, we got some stars here today. Our deputy mayor of the city of Detroit, Todd Bettison. How you doing?
Man, I feel great. It's always good to be here. It's one of my favorite places to be, and so I look forward to it.
Good. And you brought a special guest, former state senator Marsha Bullock. How you doing, man?
It's good. We haven't had a real good conversation in a long time. Hopefully, we have one today.
And y'all know Allan Lengel.
Yeah. He got the second smoothest voice.
Headline Detroit, baby.
Well, go ahead. Tell us why you're here today. And you got something seems like y'all are real passionate about.
Yes, I'm going to let Marshall kick it off, but really about the Public Safety Trust Fund. And, with my background in law enforcement and just in the street seeing too much bloodshed, I'm all about public safety. And I'm tired of seeing, you talk about outraged. I'm tired of seeing the senseless violence. I'm tired of seeing black and brown because it's the city of Detroit. I'm tired of seeing, and I'm sick of people saying enough is enough. It's time to do something about it. And so, Marshall, we can kick it off.
Well, yeah. So, you know, as a former senator, and then I was the chair of the Michigan Legislative Black Caucus, we had a lot of issues with public safety and police reform and, you know, healthcare disparities were all those things. But it always came back to the environment, the community, being safe is one of those things. You know, racism is a public health crisis for me. But we have two bills on the floor in the Senate. They came from the House. They were sponsored by Rep. Alabas Farhart and Shannon. It took a whole year to get passed through the Senate. I mean, the House. It's House Bills 4605 and 4606. And what it does is take a small portion of the sales tax, puts $100 million away for the urban city centers to get a piece of that $100 million annually based on their violent crime rate. So like Grand Rapids averages about 8-9% violent crime, they would be eligible for about 8-9 million. Detroit averages about 30, but it's capped at 25. So we could get up to 25 million. And that those police departments can use that money any way they see fit to reduce the violent crime rate in their cities.
But if you know, if I live in South Haven or Gobos or those places, why should I give you? You know what? That's not my problem.
Well, they already get money.
Yeah, but it's about perception. You know, when we're talking about takes a little bit of this and a little bit of that, how do you overcome something like that? You said it took a year.
There was some other things going on in the House. You know, they're trying to find their way a little bit. Okay. But Speaker Tavis, it seems like he's got his arms wrapped around being the leader over there in the House and getting folks together. We talked about Matic saying the crazy stuff he said. We just got through Shriver, who talked about the replacement theory. He had to take care of that guy.
You know what I'm saying?
So he's up there dealing with other things, not just the bills scenario. He's dealing with personality conflicts, ideology, all kinds of things.
When do this bill go to the Senate?
Well, it's in the Senate now. We're just waiting on it to go to committee. It's in Mary Kavanaugh's committee. Okay. We like it to come. So it came out the House like 89-11. So it passed with a bipartisan majority. No one wants to be soft on crime, especially going into an election year. So we get it. If we can get it out of committee in the Senate, then they will make sure they find a way to put it in the budget, but we got to get it out of committee first. So that's what we're just making people aware that this bill, what it again, you cannot use any of this money for facial recognition. You cannot use any of this money for chemical agents to be used on the citizen. So there are some parameters around it. And whatever monies you do get from the beginning, they'll look at it after 3 years. If you're not reducing your violent crime, you can no longer get that maximum dollars. We're not incentivizing you just to get money.
And specifically, how do you see the...
So the urban core mayors, all of the mayors of the major cities came together with this plan because a lot of the public safety dollars goes to rural America instead of in the inner city. So they get their share too. Okay. But this helps out Flint and Saginaw and Benton Harbor and Muskegon Heights and Dearborn and whoever has a little problem. Grand Rapids is heavy on it.
Let me ask you, and Todd particularly, but both of you, I mean, we talk about crime all the time, and a lot of times we're like, oh, we need more, you know, the police department has to be better and be more innovative and stuff like that. But it seems like, you know, Adolph and I went to school together. We saw kids in junior high who we knew were headed in the wrong direction. It seems like, you know, it's almost like the front lines. It's almost like places like the school.
You've seen whole families. And you know what? I hate to say this. When I was at Michigan, I took some courses where you tutored at Jackson and Maxie Boys.
And Maxie, so I work in junior high.
So I go to Jackson, and next thing I know, about five people come where I'm at, you know, from the neighborhood. Yeah. And, you know, and it's like, man, it's like guards saying, how you know them? You know, I grew up with them, you know?
I was going to throw it to you. What makes this unique is like, if we're eligible to get our $25 million, what we've been doing with community violence intervention in the city of Detroit, and we're at the forefront of this in the nation,
yes,
the mayor has designated a third of whatever we get to go to the CBI programs, the Shot Stoppers program that's been getting national attention that Deputy Mayor Bettison's been heading up along with Michael Peterson out of the city of Detroit. And so it's becoming popular. So they even added another $11 million just for community violence intervention. So he can tell you about that program. It's been working.
Well, absolutely. And so community violence intervention, people are really starting to get familiar with it. But it goes back to what you were saying, Adolph. Knowing individuals in the neighborhood, not everybody is violent, but you got 1-2% that are really the drivers, and you have other individuals that'll follow. And so with our community violence interruption program, we call it Shot Stoppers because we're invested in people. You heard a shot spotter where it detects gunfire. Community members who had already been doing this type of work for years with no funding were saying, hey, invest in us, invest in the people. So we took American Rescue Plan Act dollars, took $10 million. The mayor talked about it in his last state of the city, and we invested. And so we have six groups in the city of Detroit. Some of them you know, New Era Detroit, Detroit 300, Force Detroit, Detroit Friends and Family. And so they have specific areas that we call CBI zone in the city of Detroit. And what we did is, the areas that they have are, we did a five-year look back. Those areas, 3 to 5 square miles, are the areas where you have the most homicides and the most non-fatal shootings. And so we know that the police can go in, and they do go in, and they still police. But however, they can't stay there. And how do you change the culture? And so what I can tell you is these groups started, they kicked off last August, and we measure them quarterly, right? And so in the areas, the program is showing success in the second quarter. The Force Detroit in their area, they lowered homicides and non-fatal shootings by 72%. 72%. And in Detroit Friends and Family.
How did that happen?
Oh, violence interruptions, having credible messengers, being able to go in and identify things early. They monitor social media. They engage the neighborhood. Parents identify individuals who, you know, the ones that are, you know, most problematic. They actually help mediate and solve beef. Let me tell you how Detroit Friends and Family did it on the east side. You may have saw some of the media. They, on the east side, it's two gangs in the northeast side. It's the fours and the fives. And so we have the Bloods, we have the Crips in different sets. So everybody knows 7 Mile, 7 Mile Gratiot area, and then also Warren and Connor area. Those are two opposing groups. Well, through this work, Ray Winans and his folks have actually got a gang truce going on. And so we have people who have longstanding beef that have come together in the name of peace, and they're in the schools as well. And so gang members who typically are violent towards each other are leading by example through the program. And we saw a 50% reduction in their area.
Let me ask you this. You know, with DPS, downsizing schools, and they start putting merging schools.
Yeah,
they never addressed that gang situation, because when you close, if they Cooley closed and Kinsey closed, you send them to Mumford and all these other places, and now they fighting each other. Like,
and that's why programs like this is so important. That's why you have to have credible messengers that start to get in there and lead.
Do you work with the schools?
Absolutely.
Yes, each of these groups are in one's based out of Henry Ford, basically, one's over like near Osborne. But like you said, when they closed Rutgers and Cooley and sent everybody to Henry Ford, no one had considered the opposing factions of
the village.
So Henry Ford had at least a decade of madness going on over there, because they just
I remember when they closed Rollo Campbell and Don Darrow. And I said, this is a suburban area. And it took them almost a half a year, because they said that folks got to get acclimated to being in one school. And I said, if that's what they do over there, man, what are they doing in the city?
Yep. One of the things that's so important with this type of work, these groups prior to the American Rescue Plan Act dollars had basically been on the shoestring budget. I mean, they were funding it out of their own pockets. Oh, and so now, last August, we actually awarded groups contracts, each group for $700,000. And so we didn't just give them a little bit to fail. We gave them enough so that they could make real impact. And so, and when they hit their performance matrix, or, you know, hit the performance incentive, they actually, Detroit Friends and Family just got a performance bonus for lowering crime 10% above the citywide trend. they got 87,500. And then Force Detroit, they actually got a performance bonus because they lowered crime, homicides, and non-fatal shootings by 20%. They got a performance bonus of $175,000. So you say, well, what happens when the American Rescue Plan Act dollars, the ARPA dollars run out? That was the question. And so these House bills, Mayor Duggan is going to, after it passes, dedicate a third of our money to CBI to continue sustainability.
What's the time frame, you think?
Well, we want to get it out of, we want all this done before they go on spring break. So I mean, summer break. Right now they're on recess, but the House isn't really doing much until the two special elections are completed in April, because they're at a 54-54 impasse. But the Senate is operating at full throttle. So we want to get
the Democrats in Danville, any one of those seats?
Oh, I don't think so. I think we'll get back to 56-54. It'd be a one vote majority in both chambers. All it takes is one cantankerous individual to make it a 55. Yeah.
You were in the
Senate. I was in the Senate.
You were in the Senate at a time where you were not the majority.
We were in the minority.
And how is it to see the Democrats controlling majority? It's been a long time since both.
Well, we got the trifecta. I see opportunities that they could be doing. I mean, if I was there, it would be some other things.
Democrats. The Democrats piss me off because they in control. They don't do. Listen, Republicans say we're gonna tear up everything. We're gonna blow up the system, and they do.
Well, they operate
Democrats. Democrats. I mean, I thought Obama and everybody else could have done more than they done, but that's water under the bridge.
Yeah. So I think we can do a lot more. Last year, what they did was got what I would consider to be a lot of social bills passed. LGBTQ, abortion rights,
which are important.
So those are what they came in all gung ho on and got that passed. And now we need to make sure.
We in this segment. They got redistricting. You running them?
I mean, we don't know how these lines are going to look, and won't get drawn till next year. Right now, the problem is they just retrofitting a space. I was opposed to the bill a long time ago, but while they were drawing these lines, I knew it was going to decrease Black representation.
And
they stretched out and taken away not just the power of Black representation, but whoever the mayor of the major urban cities are. No longer has a concentrated block of their city. So now we got 23 representatives representing Detroit, 15 in the House, 8 in the Senate, but none of them have a majority of Detroit. The majority of their districts are all in the suburbs, the Cole County, Oakland County, and Western Wayne. So some of them don't even need to campaign in Detroit to still win their district.
Right. And no question. Last question before you go, Mr. Deputy Mayor, the draft. Mm-hmm. City ready to roll?
Oh my God, the city is so ready. So now, as they say, we've been on the clock, but as you can see, you're going to see stuff in the media every day. And with the road closures, we're going to be continuously doing our updates and our announcements. But our security posture is strong. We got, the various, I call it the alphabet soup of law enforcement. So everybody's contributing, helping out. So it's going to be a safe event. It's going to be a free event, because folks are calling me asking me for tickets for the draft. Download the NFL One Pass. Guess what? You're all invited. It's free. Come on down.
Can I sit in the green room?
One last question. Actually, I was out last night and I saw at the LCA.
Yes.
March Madness. What have you guys been doing? Has there been any special prep for March Madness? The
Sweet 16, Grade 8. Yeah.
We're always prepared, and so we got our prep. We got additional officers working for that as well. So we prepare. The draft was just so big, it kind of overshadowed so much. Right, but we have our officers down. Right. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hey, me back. I can come visit you anytime.
All right. Yeah, you can. Then you're welcome. Listen, like I tell the Deputy Mayor, you can come anytime you want. Just hop on in, make change. Here at Michigan and Trumbull, and we're gonna take a break.
Thanks, Charles, for letting me use your garden supplies. I'll make sure I put it back in the garage.
Man, tending to that lawn is a lot of work.
Tell you the truth, Jim, I'm more concerned about keeping this house.
What's going on?
Well, you know, Sarah lost her job 2 months ago, right?
Yeah.
Since we lost that income, the bills have been piling up, and we're so far behind. I don't want to lose the house because of back taxes. I don't know what to do.
I understand. The same thing happened to my sister and her husband when he lost his job. Do you know that the Wayne County Treasurer has plans and programs to help people stay in their homes?
No, I didn't. Tell me about it.
Yeah. Go to www.treasurer.waynecounty.com and see if you qualify.
What's that site again?
www.treasurer.waynecounty.com.
Got it.
Because you don't have to get mic'd up.
All right. We are back. I don't know if we can see that right here, but here's the NFL pass. It's free. You can also go on Deadline Detroit on the ads on top. You can click on that to register.
Yeah, I remember when I got drafted number one long time. No.
Yeah. Good, real good memory.
Yeah, right. Well, anyway.
Imagination, you mean. Yeah, well, a real good imagination.
And I thank the deputy mayor and Marshal Bullock. I really wanted to get into that redistricting. We're going to revisit it at another time. But here, our next guest, he's no stranger to Detroit Black and White. He's no stranger to Macomb County. He's no stranger to the bench. To the prosecutor's office,
right?
Of course, he's no stranger to John James, who he is running against to become a real Congress person to represent Michigan. How you doing, Carl Marlin?
I'm doing well, thank you. But I'd love to come on the show because you don't have to get mic'd up. You don't have to go in a green room. You don't have to have people put powder in your nose. This is like real people.
Right.
And if you want libations, you can even get one.
Well, you could have some interesting talk. Kind of like that.
Right. Yeah, how's the campaign going?
Okay, so the campaign's going well. A lot of volunteers. The petitions are, we're over our minimum, so we're going to keep going for another week or so to just make sure that we have a cushion because there's always challenges now, you know, we're vetting them. We're looking to make sure everything's good. So we're good on that score. Secondly, volunteers use the petition drive to get out volunteers. And we've got a goodly number. We've got petitions in the hands of 1,783 people. So that I feel best about because you have to have volunteers, especially in this age in which TV has become less important because nobody believes TV commercials anymore. You have to have door-to-door people. You have to be able to knock on doors.
When you say nobody believes TV commercials, explain that.
Well, no, when you get into the presidential cycle, the Washington people, the consultants will say, well, you got to put $2 million, $3 million on TV. Okay, and so you do. But everybody else does as well. And then the nature of the commercials are that your consultants say like the most unbelievable thing. I mean, I want to take control of it. So I want to make sure that my commercials are honest and accurate and truthful. I'm not going to go over the top, but just in general, the airwaves are so filled with unbelievable claims and attacks that people just kind of like walk by them. And so the thing that I think, and also people kind of get locked in. I mean, if you're a Trumper, it's hard to convince you that you've been conned and you're going to stay there. If you're a Democrat or somebody on the other side, you so thoroughly believe in your cause that you're not going to listen to somebody on the other side. So there's a very narrow range of people who will decide an election. Those who can be persuaded. And we have to just knock on those doors. So
what's your message in terms of?
Especially when you have 20 commercials, one right after another, you know, you start turning the channel. I know I do.
I was going to say, what's your message in terms of people say, why John James, he's not offending anyone out there. He's not doing anything crazy.
He seems not to be offending anybody, which is kind of like the core of why he shouldn't be there. He's just going along to get along. In the campaign last year, he tried to stay away from any stance on any serious issue. Now he's got a voting record. And so he tries to be a nice guy. He tries to avoid issues. And he is a nice guy. But you go there for a reason. And now he's got votes. And he's a part of this Republican study group that has turned out
I mean, and he's right at the lead of it. He wants to cut back on school lunch programs. He wants to defund part of the Affordable Care Act to make it harder for people to get insurance. The pre-existing conditions that Obamacare protected, they went out. He voted against a proposal to allow greater expansion of combined sewer overflow facilities to make sure that the water that goes into Lake St. Clair doesn't have fecal contamination. He voted against that.
Why would he vote against it?
It's all budgetary things. It's all that. We've got to cut the budget. And so the Republican study group has said, well, these are all of the areas where we can cut. But this is where the rubber hits the road. People are not going to have what they expect government to do for them.
Let me ask you this, though. You're out campaigning. Do the constituents, are they aware of this? They're not aware of this.
No. So, and that's why I say if the 30-second or one-minute advertisements are not convincing, you have to have somebody at the door to say, yeah, look, here's the bill he voted on. He actually voted against this. And they're going to say, geez, I'm surprised at that. Or for a nationwide abortion ban. I mean, there were people, my former secretary now, my call-time manager, has a daughter whose friends in last cycle were saying, oh, John James is cool. He's a helicopter pilot. You know, he's good-looking, great smile. And so Sabrina had to actually say, well, you know, there's a difference on issues, you know, like about choice. And they said, no, he can't be anti-choice. No, he is, because you get an image. It looks good. It feels good. But people have to realize that the way that you vote is going to affect your future. It's going to affect your rights. It's going to affect pollution, air quality, a lot of things. And John James is now a part of a hardcore conservative Republican group that is saying these are the things that we want to do, and it's not what the people want.
What are people telling you in Macomb? Like, what do they want to see? What Congress do that's not being done? What are the issues?
The first in Macomb, of course, we love the lakes, and so John James's vote to allow oil drilling in the Great Lakes is not going over well among duck hunters, boaters, people who love the lake. And these are people who are independents or lean Republican. And when they hear that, they say, oh, I'm just not comfortable with that. So the environment, and by the way, it also fits into a campaign theme. You know, John James moved. He was living in Farmington Hills. He's bought a house now in Shelby Township. We don't know if he actually lives there, but he's trying to pretend he's from our district, from Macomb. But so it's
so you're calling him a carpetbagger?
Well, he is. I mean, actually, this year he might be a carpetbagger because last year he didn't even move in. A carpetbagger, he says, the decency to move in.
But part of your district is Oakland County.
It is.
Are you resonating in Oakland County, or are you stronger in Macomb, or how would you characterize that?
The polling shows I'm just 2 points better in Macomb than in the Rochester Hills, and so it's really resonating throughout. And also, Rochester and Rochester Hills is part of the same, the watershed that flows from the streams and rivers in Rochester and Rochester Hills.
So they got the same issue.
So it's exactly the same issue. But anyway, the catch line that I use is that, how do we know that John James isn't really from this district? Because nobody in this district, Republican, Democrat, Liberal, Conservative, nobody in this district would ever vote to allow oil drilling and gas exploration in the lakes.
Have the Democrats in D.C. made this a priority this race?
They have. I was in D.C.
2 years ago.
Actually, I had a person with the Democratic Campaign Coalition call me a couple weeks ago and actually apologize to say, sorry that we weren't there. We just didn't think it was a winnable seat. Now with your showing, we know it is a winnable seat. Right. And I said, hey, all is forgiven as long as you're all in this.
You're nice.
Yeah. Was that galling to you?
You're nice. All is forgiven. Get out of here.
You were outspent 5-1.
That's what you need.
Yeah, well, what happens is that they set priorities at the beginning. I mean, I understand the process. I don't understand why somebody didn't knock on their door and say, hey, look at the real numbers. But you try to target so many seats. When Andy Levin said that he couldn't run in this seat because he couldn't win it, I think it was rational for the people in Washington, well, look at the guy by the name of Levin can't beat Jameson to see what's a Marlinga. I mean, how could
he wasn't like his uncle and daddy because they had some guts.
No, it's more than it's that you have to have the local knowledge. I mean, I'm there. I mean, there are Republicans who tell me you're the only Democrat I've ever voted for.
Right.
They're independents. And by the way, this is a presidential election year. I've run as prosecutor and judge in presidential years. The independents and ticket splitters trust me. And so there's a surge vote. So I will, even I don't want the people in D.C. to hear this, but even if they weren't all in, just the fact, I'm whispering this, just the fact that this is a presidential cycle means that I get about a 3-4% bump from the independents and tickets.
What about a debate? And
I will check. So John James assiduously avoids debates. In fact, we had one debate that he finally set up in front of a conservative retiree group. And I didn't care. I just wanted to have him on the record on some things. And so he showed up. But I'll give you an example. This really points it out. I sit in front of this group, a bunch of conservatives, not nice people, but believing in different things. I said, look, I am pro-choice. I know that, and there was kind of, I know that, you know, that is not your position. And I just want to ask Mr. James in front of you, what is your position on abortion and choice? And he gave this 3-minute answer, which basically just said, I really am concerned about children. I really am concerned about women. I will always listen to women. And he didn't answer the question, even in front of a very pro John James.
And he didn't even go to law school. And he knew not to answer the question.
Well, I think he's been coached. I mean, yeah.
Been coached by the guys because he didn't answer the question. But let me ask you this.
Yeah.
During that debate, how many people of color were in the audience, conservative or not? How many were in the audience? Because what I find it particularly interesting that your county has turned, you know, we talked about this last week, more brown, okay? In addition to Oakland County. So how many, it's just interesting that you have this black man who really don't want to debate at all. What does the constituency look like at that
debate?
Yes,
with at this
that
debate.
Yes, the Shady Rest crew.
All white.
Okay.
It was his handpicked crew, and it was a conservative group, and So his appeal doesn't go to the base.
They're not trying to get Afro-American voters.
I think they would be happy if they got some, but there doesn't appear to be any real effort.
Right? Are you doing any internal polling? Or?
Yeah, yeah.
What's that looking like?
Well, we're he's at 40. Well, we're neck and neck. I'll put it that way.
And
in the primary, dominant. I'm 30 points ahead of my nearest competitor. All good people, but no name recognition in the district. So
it looks like you and James gonna clash again. Is it true that on Halloween that John James was gonna dress up as Harpo Marx?
You said that. I no comment on that. No.
Harpo Marx. I'm probably say more than he do.
It's gonna be a close race.
Yeah,
it will be a close race. But the secret sauce that I have is that the polling shows that it's neck and neck. It's really, you know, we finished 48.8 to my 48.3. The polling that we've done, I don't want to be giving away numbers, but the polling shows that it basically is the same thing. Once again, we're within 1 point of one another. And so, but because we're going into the presidential cycle, I'm counting on the fact that the surge voters are going to be there. And also, but this is really important. We're going to concentrate our campaign on the door-to-door effort. I'm going to knock on doors. It's going to be like 3 state rep races. If I can get out the Bangladeshi vote, the Chaldean vote, the black vote, I have this. And so I'm going to be door-to-door myself, but volunteers, even maybe some paid staff, to make sure that we have a good turnout. In the last election, if I had gotten Senator Stabenow beat John James in these precincts by 5%. Senator Peters beat him by 1%. And so I was with somebody who said, look, basically, if you get the Stabenow numbers out of East Point and South Warren, you win. If you get the Peters there's numbers, you lose.
How about the presidential race with Biden? Is that a plus or a negative for you?
It's an even wash right now. The polling shows in the 10th district, our most recent poll, 47 for Trump, 46 for Biden. And so it's neck and neck. There won't be coattails either way, which means the candidates under the ticket can make their own pay.
And before we go, how does someone get in touch with your campaign to volunteer or give you some cash or what?
Well, the thing probably that people can remember the easiest is Marlinga for Congress, but use the number four, because Marlinga for Congress, because the Republicans bought out my name with all possible combinations. So if you go to Marlinga for Congress, it's a Republican site. Marlinga for Congress.com. That's it. Thank you.
Okay. Well, thank you, Kyle Marlinga. Good luck.
It's a pleasure. It's really good to see you guys. Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Have a great day. Thanks.
Thanks, Charles, for letting me use your gardening supplies. I'll make sure I put it back in the garage. Man, tending to that lawn is a lot of work.
Tell you the truth, Jim, I'm more concerned about keeping this house.
What's going on?
Well, you know, Sarah lost her job 2 months ago, right?
Yeah.
Since we lost that income, the bills have been piling up, and we're so far behind. I don't want to lose the house because of back taxes. I don't know what to do.
I understand. The same thing happened to my sister and her husband when he lost his job. Do you know that the Wayne County Treasurer has plans and programs to help people stay in their homes?
No, I didn't. Tell me about it.
Yeah. Go to www.treasurer.waynecounty.com and see if you qualify.
What's that site again?
www.treasurer.waynecounty.com.
Got it.
Okay, we are back here. And Adolph Mongo has left the set for a moment, but we've got 36 district candidates. I'm curious, what does it take now to run for judge? And do people know your name out there? Is it pretty?
I don't know. Have you asked people if they know my name?
I don't know. Well, I know you're here.
Some people remember me from when I ran for Congress years ago. People know me from all that time it was on the radio.
Right.
People know me from not just that, but from the courtroom.
Right.
I've practiced in four areas of law, which is criminal, probate, family, and neglect and abuse and delinquency cases. Mm-hmm. I've been in private practice for 22 years.
Wow.
And people know me from that. People know me from working in the community. In addition to that, I worked in a public school. I worked in Highland Park Public Schools. I taught at the high school. High school that
what
they tore down. History.
Wow. Really?
And then I did some contract work with DPS. Okay. So there's a lot
did
of people.
Did you think that slavery taught us how to be a career?
Yeah, I did. What I have found is there are people that are reaching out to me from every facet of my life, which is interesting. Yesterday I was out. I went to TULC. Everybody was there Friday, and I left there, and I went over on the east side. Now, what's interesting about me is that when I say I am Detroit, I am Detroit. He used to tease me. He was like, "Was your family gypsy?" I'm like, "Yeah, basically." But I grew up
that's
in
the
city.
That's not the right word anymore.
Right. Well, right. But that's what you asked me. Okay. But I grew up on the east side. I mean, west side and the east side. So yesterday I was on the east side doing some campaigning. And as a matter of fact, one of our guests is coming in a few minutes. Is from the east side.
I have a question. You know, and I'm wondering if you've had this experience, like with Deadline Detroit. When I talk to people and I'd say, "Oh yeah, I have Deadline Detroit," and some people go, "No, no, what is that?" And I'd be surprised they hadn't heard of it. And other times, let's say Deadline Detroit, they'd be like, "Oh my gosh, Deadline Detroit." So do you get that sometimes where they go,
"Oh yeah,
no, tell me who you are," or sometimes be like, "Yeah, yeah, I know who you are."
And what you also find is a lot of people are now, "What's your name?" And then they'll Google me immediately right in front of my face.
Oh, really?
Even with people that were out getting signatures, they Googled me, which is quite interesting. But yeah, I get mixed bag. And you know, sometimes I have somebody come and speak, and I'm like, where do I know this person from? It's not like I'm 5 years old, you know, I'm seasoned. So I'm like, where do I know these people? But they may know me from here, or from radio, or teaching, or whatever. So yeah.
Okay.
So
we got
some happy hitters in here today. So good morning. At the beginning of the month, we talked about this being Women History Month, and we wanted women all month. So one of the women that I reached out to is somebody that I admire. She's a very good friend, very good friend. She's family.
And she happens to be the wife.
To be I don't know how she put up with them. She happens to be the wife of Adolph Mongo, Dr. Jonella Mongo.
Well, hello, and thank you so much for having me. You know, I'm known to carry around bags.
Oh, yeah, I see.
Most of the time, they're full of books. And so today, in celebration of Women's History Month, as well as National Reading Month, I brought along a book about women.
They're on the screen.
Yes. So here we are. I will get started and pull my books out as I
tell us. Tell us a little bit about your background, so people know.
I'm a former K-12 educator as well as a professor. Working with pre-service teachers. I currently do consulting work, and I teach every now and then at Wayne County Community College.
Hey, what are you teaching there?
I'm doing early child education.
Okay, cool.
So training our teachers to work with the babies. So my books, I'll just kind of highlight some of the ones that I think folks of all ages, and I usually have something for infants through adults. So I'm going to start with one of my favorites, and you'll hear me say favorites a lot.
Okay.
But these two are both by Ruby Bridges, and all of you should know Ruby Bridges. The young girl who really broke the barrier for integrating schools. And she has a new picture book out called Dear Ruby, where she's received lots of letters from young people, and she responds to their letters related to equality, environmental issues, kind of the run of the gamut. The next one, this one, and I know you guys have your setup, but hopefully you can see them. I tried to bring something
that looks for like a very
every,
cool book.
Yes, for every age level. And these are all about our wonderful first African-American First Lady, Michelle Obama. So there's the board book for the babies.
What grade level is this?
This would be birth to age 3 or 4.
So it's a pretty, a lot, very kind of simple.
I like the illustration.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Very cool. Very cool book. Wow.
Really, a first introduction to Michelle Obama. And then this one is about Michelle's garden that she started in the White House.
Wow.
And so that would be for more 4 to 8 year olds. And then we have something for the 8 to 9, 10 year olds, a biography.
And are these in bookstores, or you got to get it on Amazon?
Well, you can get them pretty much anywhere. You know, you sometimes even, I say this, places like TJ Maxx will have these books.
Oh, really?
But Target, Amazon, Costco's. And the library. Folks, use the library. A lot of these books can get really pricey.
You can sign them out. Yeah,
and you can
library.
Sign them out. Most local libraries will have them.
So you mentioned the library. I know you probably read the article in the newspaper about some of the Detroit public libraries closing and not, you know, people would not have access to the libraries. Mm-hmm. What is your opinion about that?
Well, you know, whenever you close a library or a bookstore and you limit access to reading high quality material, it's really a travesty. So when we're trying to look at funding, when we're, you know, you guys are into the politics, when we're electing officials, we really need to elect folks who care about literacy. Because if we don't do something about literacy, nothing else will matter. If folks can't read and write,
I've seen in other cities some libraries, more modern libraries, where they have coffee shops in there and stuff like that. Detroit needs to get a little bit more progressive about its libraries and creating more community center. It used to be like Borders Books, Barnes & Noble.
Right.
People would go there. You go on a Saturday or any time and people are reading books and having coffee and stuff. And it seems like an ideal opportunity for the city of Detroit to...
So, and you know, the schools have had a tough time keeping their libraries open. So we really do need to do something. Last week we had, I worked with a nonprofit called Legacy of Literacy Incorporated, and we sponsored for Reading Month, Real Kids Read Day. And so we were in River Rouge at the public library and they hosted senior citizens came and children read aloud to them.
Okay,
so that's a great turnout, wonderful turnout.
And this book here, is that for kids as well?
This is Michelle Obama's Becoming, and she adapted it for our younger readers, middle school, high school.
Picture of her when she was a kid.
And of course, she has her adult version as well. So Michelle Obama, you can find something on her across all age levels. This one, of course, is about our current VP, Kamala Harris.
Which age?
And this is, the picture books are usually 4 to 8, 4 to 9. The little chapter books, this is hot off the press. And they have beautiful illustrations.
Yes.
That one was written by Nikki Grimes and illustrated by Laura Freeman. And they're a great team. This one is by Dr. Tanya Lewis. And she does, this is a series of books, biographies. They call them the story of. So that's the story of Kamala Harris. And then this one is the story of Katherine Johnson. And you guys know the movie Hidden Figures. So you know what exciting and award-winning work those ladies did. These are some more on Katherine Johnson.
This woman has books.
Yeah, listen here.
It's Women History Month, and what I think is so great is that all the books that she's bought to display, and I know that she has a lot of books. As a matter of fact, they were trying to give me some of their books because they have them in storage. But all the books that she's highlighting are about women and great women, trailblazers. And I think that is awesome. And the fact that you can start off from zero to, and you could go to 100 years old and read these books. That's awesome.
Right. So these are both Katherine Johnson. And I have a few more about some other women that might not be quite as known as some of our other ones. But Ethel Payne, if you know, if you're into journalism, you know she was one of the first, in fact, the first African-American woman to be allowed in the White House press room and work under as a journalist through several administrations. And Lisa Klein, and I also highlight these books, and you might notice that most of them are about African-American women because for many years, we I did a column along with two colleagues, Dr. Tony Walters and Dr. Vivian Johnson called Between the Covers, Literature for Our Children, either written by or illustrated by African Americans. And so that's why my collection is really pretty comprehensive in terms of African American authored and or illustrated books, because for many years,
right,
there was very little diversity in children's literature. So I also have Augusta Baker, who was one of the first librarians and master storytellers. This is another cool one. And I'll just bring out a couple related to entrepreneurs. We have several that young people can, and adults. Many of these books I will read, and then it motivates me to go do additional research on the individual. So this is a brand new one, hot off the press. Miles of Styles, Eunice Johnson, and the Ebony Fashion Fair. So just a wonderful story about her life and her starting the fashion fair.
Show the back of it. Show the back of the book.
And that one's illustrated by, I think that's Christian Robinson, who's an award-winning illustrator. Just fabulous work. Oh, Lynn Carr Gaines. I'm sorry, that's Lynn Gaines. All right, and Madam C.J. Walker, you may know her as the entrepreneur, something for upper elementary. And then, of course, one for the adults that recently published about Sheila Johnson. So we have lots of trailblazers across all professions. I have a few in here on the arts, and then my bag will be empty.
I love that.
This one about Nina Simone, a story of Nina Simone. And this one is illustrated by Christian Robinson. And this is Tracy Todd's first children's book. So fabulous, fabulous work.
Take a look at some illustrations.
Yeah, some of his illustrations. Yes. And then, of course, our own homegrown young lady, a voice named Aretha.
All right. Well done.
Highlights her upbringing here in Detroit. And then one of my favorites, Misty Copeland. In fact, she was on one of the national news shows the other day talking about racism and the impact it had on her career as a ballerina. And then this last one is just a collection. It's called Brave Black First, 50 plus African American women who changed the world. And if you want to invest in a book, this is one I would certainly invest in. And when young people have projects to do for Black History Month or Women's History Month or whatever, you know, these are great resources, and some of them are online on YouTube with authors or either other folks reading them aloud. So you don't always have to spend money. Some of these books are readily available. So another really good one to celebrate women, African-American women. And so thank you so much for having me.
Thank you so much.
I know I rushed through my book,
but you got to come back.
I thought we were going to do the more interesting thing and talk about what it's like to be married at all.
Oh, she's not going to do that. But this is one of the people that is attacking the fact that literacy is an issue in the community. And she is one of those people that is in the forefront. Thank you so much for coming.
Oh, you are so welcome. Thank you for having me.
You're going to come because I know you're a little bit shy.
Well, you know, when I'm talking about my books and literacy, a whole nother side.
Eric,
I am too.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much. No, I'm going to pop out.
Okay.
Thank you so much. Appreciate you guys.
All right.
Thanks, Charles, for letting me use your gardening supplies. I'll make sure I put it back in the garage. Man, tending to that lawn is a lot of work.
Tell you the truth, Jim, I'm more concerned about keeping this house.
What's going on?
Well, you know, Sarah lost her job 2 months ago, right?
Yeah.
Since we lost that income, the bills have been piling up, and we're so far behind. I don't want to lose the house because of back taxes. I don't know what to do.
I understand. The same thing happened to my sister and her husband when he lost his job. Do you know that the Wayne County Treasurer has plans and programs to help people stay in their homes?
No, I didn't. Tell me about it.
Yeah. Go to www.treasurer.waynecounty.com and see if you qualify.
What's that site again?
www.treasurer.waynecounty.com.
Got it.
Yeah. All right. We are back.
We're back, and we have, in celebration of Women's History Month, we're back with another woman guest, and in my view, another trailblazer in the community. I was out a few weeks ago campaigning, and I ran into her husband, and her husband said, "Hey, Vanessa, I was on the east side on Gratiot at Triangle Hardware." And they said, "Hey, why don't you come on down? My wife owns a convenience store. It's a candy store. Why don't you come on down and meet her?" So we went down and we talked, and actually we bonded. We found out that we had so much in common.
Yes.
And particularly on that side of town, she grew up on that side of town as well. And she indicated that there was a need in that community. If you guys are familiar, she's on Gratiot. What's it? Gratiot. What's the social?
It's Gratiot and Odell.
Right, Gratiot and Odell. There's a candy store, and most of us, when we grew up, we had a candy store in the neighborhood.
Listen, we had three. We had Sister Grant that had a house. She was from Jamaica. Mm-hmm. You go in the house, she sit by the door. With a table, and she sell you the candy. Then we had Bruce's truck. It was a truck, and you go in there and you buy stuff. But I want to say, behind every great woman, that there's a man that make you great. But you talk about but penny candy, there's no such thing as penny candy anymore.
No, it's not. And actually, when I started visioning it, I wanted to go back like back in the day when I was coming up. Uh-huh. We don't have that no more in the neighborhood. I wanted to, actually, when I was sitting in the store, I went in there with a whole nother plan. And when I sat there, it was one chair and windows around. I sat there and I looked out the windows. And I was noticing people walking back and forth. But it was taking a long time for them to get to one end to the next end, and they was coming with bags. So I'm like, where is they going? Where's the store at? So that's when I started paying attention. So I'm still.
Is that the correct address?
Yes, it is. Okay. Thank you. And so, you know, someone from the community came and knocked on the door like, "Hey, you have some candy in there?" So that's when it came to me like, this neighborhood needs a store, like something with some goodies in there.
You get a lot of school kids?
I do. I get a lot of everybody in there, actually. I actually have like small household items, personal care items. I'm basically a store. I just don't have the beer, liquor, and wine. But I sell everything else. I do. Have y'all had the biscuit donuts when y'all were kids growing up? Like the biscuits made out of donuts? My grandmother used to make these biscuits for us. She used to make them out of donuts. And I've just had a vision that I'm about to bring that to the neighborhood too. So I do fresh hot biscuit donuts with different dipping sauces.
Why didn't you bring us?
I should have brought you guys.
Itasha, when we talked, you indicated that is, you know, you felt like there was a need in that neighborhood.
Yes.
But tell us, do you have another store?
Yes, I have another store. It's actually a Hooper store. And that's the first location. I had that store since 2019. And that's what I was going with this. But when I got over there, I'm like, we don't need no Hooper store over here. It's a lot of elderly people over here. It's a lot of children over here. And there's no store for them. I didn't know it was going to take a lot of work because I had a bigger plan now. And I didn't go in with that plan. But some way, somehow, I've been walking through it. And
talk about the products that you sell. You sell a lot of candy.
I sell penny candy.
No. Laters.
I have chips, all different types.
Yeah, slow pokes.
I'm gonna get slow
black pokes. Cow.
And something. See, that's what I be needing. I always take ideas. When I first got over in the neighborhood, you know, I have a lot of people. I was in the nursing field since 2000, and that's what I've been doing. I worked the whole pandemic, and I was in a car accident last year in February. You know, I was working full time and then I was still doing my hookah store. And I didn't envision this much with the convenience store because it wasn't that much work with the hookah store. But out of faith, I stepped out on faith and I just said, you know what, I'm gonna do something where the kids can, you know, they can come in and
What's the challenges of running a convenience store? It seems like a hard business to run.
It's just a lot of keeping up with all the stuff because I run out fast.
The inventory.
Yeah. How much is a piece of candy these days?
Not like it used to be. Well, like a candy bar, it's no more penny candy no more. No, we used to be penny candy, but I overdo it. I look out for the people. That's just me. I always get them more than, you know, what that money is. But it's like 2 cents, 3 cents. You know, we used to get like $1, 100 pieces of candy. We don't get that no more.
Got any Mary Jane?
Yes. You know I had to get some Mary Jane.
And a candy bar, what is that?
$1.50.
$1.50 for like an Almond Joy or a Clark Bar or whatever.
$1.50. It's no more 25-cent chips.
You got Almond Joy?
Yes, I do. I love Almond Joy.
And is that very profitable? Is there a good profit on that?
You know it's profitable.
It's fair. It pay the bill.
Okay.
I get to pay my bills.
Okay.
So long as I can pay my bills and keep my store up and running, I feel like I'll be fine. And actually, I love to do that. I wouldn't never picture myself in this storefront running the store because it's a 7-day job.
And have you created a sense of community? You feel like you're a center?
They love me over there.
You sell pie?
I sell pie. Juices, Pepsi, Fago, Everfresh. I sell the
Better Make.
Better Make us right down the street.
And that's all the, like I said, I grew up off of that. So I tried to go a little bit old school and new school. So what I did is when I got over there, I was raised up, my grandmother stayed a few blocks down from here. So I was familiar with the neighborhood. It used to be a store right on French Road and Gratiot, but they shut it down and they put a dispensary right here. So I was thinking like they already got something over here that, you know, they already took the store away from the neighborhood. So I'm like, we've been alive in this neighborhood up with some goodies. And so that's where.
And you sell bread and eggs?
You
know what?
And ice cream.
And I was going to get to that. So when I got over there, I wanted to pass out my flyers myself, and I did it by myself. I actually went and drove my car through the block, knocked on people's door. They asked if I told them who I was, what I was trying to do. And I also asked them, what would it be that y'all would like for me to have at the store for y'all that would be convenient for y'all? Y'all know what everybody said?
Right.
Ice cream. I wasn't going in there to do no hair. I had ice cream. So you know what I did? I went and bought a deep freezer, and I went and got some ice cream.
Okay.
What kind of ice cream are you? What brands are you selling?
Right now, I do like just like different. I go to this store called Eddie's. It's the Penny Candy store too. It's okay. In East Point, Detroit, East Point, Michigan. I'm sorry. So I go there and I get my ice cream. He let me get the ice cream from him. Because right now, I'm small. I don't want to buy too much big because it'll go to
waste. Really, it is right. East Detroit. Right. That's where they just changed the name. Right. We need to come.
We need to come and do
a live show. From there, you're going to give us some candy?
You I'm going to give us some candy, make out some donuts. I also have coffee, tea, hot chocolate.
Oh, you all right with me.
What are your hours?
Your address?
My hours is from 9 to 9. My address is 10384 Gratiot. I'm on the corner of No Deal, right next to McDonald's. Okay.
And I'm sorry, the hours are?
From 9 a.m. to 9 p.m.
If they want to call you, what's your telephone?
My telephone number is 248-757-7272.
And say the name of
my Dream Alert convenience store.
Okay.
And my name is Itasha, and I hope to see you guys there. You won't.
And what's your husband's name? You gotta get him some.
His name is Mike. Mike. He's a people person.
And you know, it always take teamwork.
Yeah, it
takes teamwork to make the dream.
Is he working in the store as well?
No, actually, he's have his own maintenance.
They don't want to see him.
When other people do be in there, like, you know, because my cousin, she been there with me from day one. She helped me, my cousin Monique, she helped me out a lot when she's not, you know, doing hair or working herself.
And where she work at, so we can give her a play.
Yep, she worked at Villa Nursing Home, and she also does hair. So she juggles it, but she's still making a way to help, you know, to come and help me out.
Good. And you know what? And thank you for coming.
Yeah. She said she's helping me on my campaign. So
I'm getting them awesome. Yeah, we're gonna get hurt.
Well, you know, you owe us a lot of money. Don't you, right?
We're not
here. There ain't no credit invoice
coming. Thank you.
And I want to thank all our guests today. Yeah. The deputy mayor, Marshall Bullock. You know what? I was really pissed that he had to run against in that new district. And I said, Marshall, let's throw some dirt. He said, I'm above board. He didn't want to do that.
Right. Yeah.
No question. Teresa, thank you very much.
Jim.
Jim, do you want to say that Jim and I are done?
I'm just going right behind you.
Go ahead.
So this Thursday, last Thursday, I should say, we did a podcast down at Ramsey's in Trenton and talked to the Wayne County Sheriff, Raphael Washington. And the election's coming up. Really, the election is in August, correct? Right.
Yes.
It is the primary. And whoever wins the Democratic primary,
they're gonna win the general.
We'll walk right into the general election. So take a look. It was a very good podcast. I thought he was engaging.
Yeah.
And it was an enjoyable.
You can see it on YouTube, Facebook, LinkedIn.
Deadline Detroit, right?
Yep. Instagram, Telegram, Billy Graham, and all that other gram. And remember, Vanessa Moss is running for judge.
Yes,
District Court.
Okay, we'll be back next week. Detroit in Black and White. Thank you, Allan Lengel.
Thank you,
Vanessa Moss, Jim, Teresa, and thank
Itasha.
You.
Yes,
I want some of that candy.